Today we are going to look at the Jason Jolkowski's case, who disappeared on the 13th of June in 2001. Jason was 19 years old at the time. He is described as having a very sweet nature, the kind of young man that everyone liked and was easy to get on with. Jason was a very active young person. He was involved in his church as a volunteer. He was called upon to read specific passages during Mass. I believe it was Catholic Church. He had a part-time job at a local restaurant to give himself a little financial independence. He was a hard-working student, having graduated from high school. He went on to studying part-time at a local community college. He had enrolled in a radio broadcasting program, and he was also working on the school's radio station, and it said that he'd gained quite a following. He was really into sports and had all sorts of athletic knowledge. His family have said that in all likelihood he would have pursued becoming a sports radio broadcaster because he loved it so much. All these things, I say, are already pretty impressive for the average teenager, but particularly so because the thing about Jason was he he had a learning difficulty, meaning that his brain would take a little longer to process things than the average person. He was pretty incredible at overcoming these things that most of us take for granted, including stuff like getting his driver's license, which took him a long time to achieve, but still he succeeded in passing his test, and he went on to drive his own car. I just can't express enough how very impressive this young man was. Talking about his setback, you would notice he was struggling, especially if there were a lot of background noises. And in quieter spaces as well, he would still need to take more time than most people to process what was being said to him. So, for example, he would be working out if what had been said was a question, or was it just a comment? And then he would be able to come up say back. It wasn't an easy thing for him. So there could often be a slightly longer pause from him before he would answer, or he could potentially need to ask to repeat a part of what had been said, but it's important note that other than taking longer to understand and then form a reply, he was absolutely fine. Unfortunately, though, as is so often the case. Kids at school did lay into him. Why do kids do these things? I don't know. From my research on Jason's case, I understand that he never really pinpointed specific individuals, so no one ever got called out for bullying him, but like with everything else, he just got through it. So let's turn to the day that he vanished. Wednesday, the 13th of June, 2001. He was due to go into his part-time job at the restaurant for the afternoon shift. Except on this day, they were short-staffed, and Jason was asked if he could take an earlier shift that morning. He said he was happy to go in earlier. Unfortunately, his car was at the mechanics, and so he didn't have a way to get there. So work people organized female colleague, whose name, by the way, I don't know, so she went to go pick him up, but because it was too complicated to give directions on how to get to his family address, he suggested she meet him at his old high school, which she knew and was just about 10 minutes away for him on foot. This was a walk he had done for years whilst he attended classes there. His younger brother was home with him that morning, and he last saw Jason at 10:45. He and the colleague agreed she arrived at the school premises a little later than expected at 11:15 before I go any further. I want to add that this colleague was questioned, investigated, cleared of having anything to do with Jason's disappearance. When she got to the high school and couldn't see him anywhere, she wasn't sure what to do. Remember, this is back in 2001, where it wasn't necessarily common to own your own mobile or cell phone. She didn't have one of her own. Found a payphone at a little petrol station. It's just on the corner from the school. She rang work to let them know that Jason was nowhere be seen. He didn't appear to have shown up. They told her to hang back, wait for a little longer. He might still show up, but otherwise make her way back after a short while. Then work called Jason's family house number again to see if for any reason he might still be. Jason's younger brother picked up, and when they asked, the brother automatically said Jason had left the house and gone to his park. Which was weird because obviously it was work people who were phoning to find out where he was. The colleague eventually gave up and drove back into work without him, and his parents were contacted. Initially, the police put it down to a teenager voluntarily taking off of his own free will, but obviously his family knew different. That couldn't be the case. It was a shocking 10 full days before the police started taking proper action, and the media got involved as well. As a community volunteer walking search where people walked from the family home, they went down alleyways, poked around, but no one ever found anything. Nothing came of it. There were CCTV cameras in and around the area of the school premises, which were looked Jason never appears on any of them, which tells us he never got that far. So, at least it helps eliminate that area completely. The area that they lived in is a small neighborhood, which is part of the larger city of Omaha in Nebraska. At the time, it was predominantly residential. It had a quaint park just a block away. And the park lacked swings or equipment. It's just a square of well-maintained grass with a few benches. The neighborhood had some blocks consisting of older, more established homes, which were well-maintained, and there were never any issues with neighbors. However, there were just a few blocks away, there were pockets of areas that were in decline. About a mile away, there was a dodgy path. Their neighborhood was located on the border of that area. Nevertheless, Jason's route that morning from home to the high school entirely safe. He would not have had to cross that sketchy part of town. It needs to be said that there were known sex offenders living in that area at the time. Again, there were no leads that came from investigating them further. There was also a known older man who worked befriending younger males and inviting them back to his home, but that man was also checked out, and investigators didn't find anything suspicious about him. Police also looked into his disappearance, possibly being connected to coming into contact with anyone from back in high school. From the days when he'd been bullied, but ultimately they came up with nothing. It was complicated in that there were no specific names of pupils, so it was a dead end. A significant factor is Jason's height. He was tall at 6'1", which leans towards the thought that he wouldn't immediately stand out as an easy target for someone to abduct in broad daylight. If you were to try, he would naturally put up some sort of fight. Keeping in mind that Jason vanished around 11 o'clock in the morning, which further adds to the complexity of this case. However, then we've got to remember that he had a very gentle demeanor. His family had voiced how he wouldn't think ill of most people. He would be physique, but what if someone knew he wouldn't put up much of a fight because they already knew he'd be so trusting? Doing, walking along the road, and they told him to jump in. What if they'd offered to give him a lift the short distance to the school? That he would be so trusting of someone potentially known to him was, in my opinion, the most likely sequence of events that took place. Then there's another scenario. If Jason was at the wrong place at the wrong time, what if he accidentally walked past something like a drug deal and a gun was pointed at him? Size, height, strength, those no longer matter. Please leave your comments on the case. What do you think? I want to make a brief mention about the supposed disappearance of another young man living in the same area, also in 2001. Being referred to as Sam Sherman. It turns out that Sam was not missing. He had just taken off for a few days and then returned home. I believe the confusion was in his name. Sherman is his middle name, not his surname, so seems to be a mix up here. This individual didn't know he was considered a missing person and therefore remained on nameless unnecessarily, but as a result, many have connected the two cases as they're reported in the same year from the same location. Which looked suspicious. Sadly, it's Jason who is still missing, and it is his case that remains unsolved, which leads me to say someone out there knows what happened to Jason. People always talk. If you have any information about Jason's disappearance, please contact the Omaha Police Department